Aloha and welcome to the Ruderman Roundtable. I'm State Senator Russell Ruderman from the Puna District on the Big Island. And we host this every other week show talking about good government, politics, and environmental issues. Today my guest is Kyle Datta. Thank you for joining me, Kyle.
Very good to be here, Russell.
Thank you. Kyle Datta is general partner of the Ulupono Initiative and is responsible for developing Ulupono Initiative's partnerships with stakeholders, policymakers, and community organizations. Kyle also oversees the organization's systems thinking approach to strategy development and transformation and is a member of Ulupono's management team. Kyle in the past has been managing director of the Rocky Mountain Institute and the head of U.S. Utilities Practice and managing director of the Asian Utilities Practice for Booz Allen. Kyle received a master's degree in public and private management from the Yale School of Organization and Management, as well as a master's degree in environmental science and resource economics from the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. Aloha and welcome to the Ruderman Roundtable.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. So let's talk about the Ulupono is, among other things, very involved in agriculture. It's a big interest of mine. So let's start by talking about the state's local food goals and where we are with that. What's next, you think?
Well, one of our goals is to actually triple where we are, and then the government wants to double it. We'd like to get to 30%.
Wonderful.
And if you look at where are we starting from, we actually have a strong base in fruits and vegetables. We actually produce about 40% of those, a reasonably good aquatic fishery. But we're very, very weak in the major proteins. Mm-hmm. So that's your beef. Don't really have any commercial broiler chickens. We have a small amount of eggs, and your pigs, and then the milk and dairy products.
Uh-huh. Okay. So you folks have been partnering with private organizations to help get that going?
Yeah, so the way Ulupono works is we're an investment initiative, uh-huh. and so we're a hybrid. We're both an investing group, so we make investments with local companies to increase local food. We're also venture philanthropy, so we help on things like school gardens and farm to school. Because in part of the long-term systems thinking is you think about the younger generation and, of course, what they eat in school and what they'll remember when they grow older. And they'll also have that relationship with the farmer at an early age, which means later in their lives they'll seek that out as consumers. Mm-hmm. So we think that entire process of kind of early exposure to local food and the interaction, that's very important in a philanthropic sense. And then at an investment level, we really try to partner with our local farmers, ranchers, fishermen, the institutions, so that we're able to make them more commercially successful and supply food that's both affordable and sustainable.
Very nice. That's great to start with the kids because, you know, it's a great, they're still influenceable, and they're going to be our future.
Absolutely.
Of course. Yeah, it's wonderful. So you're very active with the school garden programs. And so as a state, we've been trying to do as much as we can to double food production. You mentioned your goal is to triple it. How do you think the state should be directing efforts towards that goal?
Great question. So let's talk about the basics from the whole system perspective, because we are system investors. So the foundation of agriculture is always affordable land with tenure, affordable water that's accessible, labor, and then I think food safety is becoming an important issue to help our farmers get through these hurdles. So that's the basics. The next level from that to make food economical and to be profitable is, of course, value-added processing, making sure the supply chain works, that's your cold storage, your distribution, and then the value-added helps lift up the lower quality products from, you know, into value-added products, so sort of your cabbage into coleslaw, your ketchup, your tomatoes into ketchup. So those are the elements that you have to work on. There's a number of areas where I think the state, you know, can help. I mean, clearly, starting from the basics, it's where we have, you know, state lands and different agencies, making them available with the tenure and affordability we need. Clearly, the water systems are the key to food safety.
The water systems.
You can't pass food safety if your surface water, which is what's affordable, has a problem, right? You won't, downstream, the farmers won't pass food safety. So there's an importance for the state that controls a number of these surface water systems to look at what's the most affordable water treatment approach before it gets to the farmer, because under the food safety regulations, they're going to need a certain level if they're going to do some of the washing and processing operations on those sites. We applaud the legislature, knock on wood, around hopefully tomorrow there'll be a bill that will be passed to help farmers through the food safety certification hurdles, which are bureaucratic and challenging. It's good the state's doing some of that. And then I think as we move forward and start to look at the value-added areas, I think those become much more private sector endeavors, ways the private sector works with other private sector groups. In many ways, you know, KTH has shown us the way and all the things they've done the Big Island to look at where are our surpluses, who can process, how can we market and retail, and to start to create a whole set of products, everything from pickles to pog. But, you know, we'll see the same thing now, I think, in some of the meats that are going to come out of these various grass-fed initiatives around the state, and eventually fish as well.
You mentioned land with tenure. Tell me why tenure is so important to farmers.
Well, you know, I started out in Hawaii as a farmer, and my brother's still a farmer, so it's near and dear to issues to my heart. And, you know, you can't make the investment. You know, you can't ask a farmer who, you know, those farmers wake up, they wake up at like at 6 in the morning, they go to bed at sunset. They work, you know, 12-hour days hard. And you can't ask people to make the investments in the infrastructure, right? They're going to clear the fields, they're going to put in irrigation systems, they're going to do a lot of things unless they know they've got at least, you know, 10 years in that property. You can't grow an orchard without 20 years in the property. Right. The trees take 5 years to grow. And you want all these things to happen, so tenure becomes very, very important for farmers to make that investment. And, you know, the other challenge we have, as you well know, is there's not a lot of fee simple land that's priced at levels that I can afford. So the importance of land that is publicly controlled, that could be leased at affordable rates, and getting sort of that to move out into the private sector for all the farmers and ranchers that can use that is very, very important.
I know when I talk, go to some farmers, I'm not a farmer myself, but I go to some farmer meetings and stuff, and they talk about if you don't have a long-term lease or ownership of the land, then you can't get financing. Let's say you want to put in irrigation or processing facilities.
That's absolutely true. That's the other side of it.
You need that for that too.
Right. If you don't have, you have to, clearly if you own the land, you can get financing, and that's going to be a subset. If you have a long enough lease, you can get some types of financing. Normally, especially if you're able to put some kind of a building on it, which then the banks at least feel they have some collateral, something happens. But yes, it's very important for that as well.
You know, I'm intrigued when you talk about value-added food production and how it's mostly going to be a private sector initiative. Are there ways that the government can help promote with certain infrastructure, or what could the public sector do to stimulate and support that development?
Well, I'm glad you asked, the city senator. So the number one thing that the Hawaii state government can do, I think, is actually going to be around procurement. Because if there's a market, then the private sector will step up and meet that market. And I think there's been a lot of work under Lieutenant Governor to really start to harness the Department of Education for their buying power. But let's not forget hospitals, schools, and prisons. Right. All three together are the buying power of the state. So those longer-term contracts is something where if they ask for it, then the market, it helps create that financeability. Then you have a large, you know, anchor customer. You know, we do have, there are, of course, commercial spaces that are also, just like land, are also available for lease. I don't necessarily think the economics require tax credits or those kinds of things. It's not that kind of an ask. There is, I think, there one area where there's a gap, and it really is probably going to be some form of public-private partnership, is if you look at the cold chain. And the cold chain is so important because when a farmer in a tropical place like Hawaii harvests their crops, it's very hot. As the crops will start to wilt immediately, and they need to have find a place to have that cold, the crops preserved, so it has to stay cold. So it has to be a close cold chain, followed by when you get to the harbors and you want to move it from a neighbor island to Oahu, where the market really is, you also need, obviously, cold storage near the harbors. And there's a lot, there's a real scarcity of cold storage near the harbors, and that whole question of the cold chain and where are the hot spots where we would, if we put in infrastructure, that would make a difference. And the government has helped in our own Big Island in Waimea. You know, the Waimea cooling plant is a good example where money's been put out to help them improve the efficiency of that plant, because, of course, coal is expensive when you think about the energy costs. So, but the major infrastructure issue would be for processing would be the cold chain. That's a good role. That's a good public-private role for government to play.
Okay, good. And tell me, I have this idea. I'm a grocer, as you know, and I watch us import so much beverages from the mainland. And it seems to me we could have a much more robust beverage manufacturing industry here if we could solve the container situation. Mm-hmm. In other words, my idea is to let's do recycled glass here mm-hmm. in Hawaii mm-hmm. and have glass bottles of maybe a few different sizes available mm-hmm. that people could then manufacture, because it's almost prohibitive to import empty glass containers to mm-hmm. Hawaii and then make a product that can be profitable on. Mm-hmm. You think the government might have some role to play in that, or is that too far down the road?
They might. I think you might be able to see that vision happen in plastics a little earlier, only because the economics of taking plastics and reusing them and having that sort of bottle extruding is a little less of a capital hurdle than trying to put in glass recycling. Just mm-hmm. a different kind of capital hurdle to do that. Although the glass rewashing is something which is much less.
Yes.
So depending on the bottles you bring in, having them recycle in certain product lines could actually work well. But you're absolutely right on the beverages. I mean, shipping water, of course, is just a crime when you actually have great water. Mm-hmm. And we actually, a lot of the things that we want to drink, whether it be iced teas or various things, are things that our farmers can grow here, right? As additional crops that create value to them beyond the food crops. And those specialty crops are very helpful to the farmers in terms of using all their land. So I think there's definitely a business model there, and there might be some things that government can do to help in terms of supporting some of the feasibility work around those kind of industries, because we have a good history of building up some industries like that.
Hmm.
And as a Hawaii, we tried to bring in various industries. There's a role, I think, when industries are starting, and then after that, the private sector should take its kuleana mm-hmm. and take the risk and do that.
So how can the public stakeholders take on a larger role in developing our agriculture?
I think that's a great question. I mean, the number one thing is really what you buy.
Mm-hmm.
No one regulates. It's not like alternative energy where you sort of regulate how many electrons are in the public system, out in the main system, and then of course you have a choice of putting solar on your roof. No one's forcing you to go eat that particular food. So, where you shop, what you buy, and I don't think the public understands how much retailers pay attention to this.
Mm-hmm.
They really watch the trends. They're very, very sophisticated now, and if they see the public supporting a new product, especially when new products are launched, because it's such a scary time. We worked at Parker Ranch and launched grass-fed beef at Safeway, the Paniola brand, and having that surge of consumers show up at these Target stores and buy the product, be very happy with the product, come back and tell their friends to buy more, the beginnings really give retailers confidence to create more shelf space. And it's a wonderful, as you know, you're a grocer, it's a wonderful self-reinforcing thing where if the public shows up to support new products, local products, everyone's making profit, you get more, and they're more comfortable doing that, and that just sort of builds scale in the chain. So that's the number one thing to do. The second is, it is actually, elections do matter. They really do. And it's not just the national level. I think it's important to, all the way down to the county council, really make sure that there's public participation in the democratic process where local food is part of the agenda item, not just because you care about your kids, because all of us care about our kids, we want them to eat healthier, and it really will help them eat healthier and help solve a lot of population morbidity problems, but also because you care about your neighbor mm-hmm. and you want the economy to grow. And as you think about it, like look at the county we both live in, the Big Island. If you could create jobs in Kau, in Puna, in Hamakua, what happens? Then all those people don't commute to Hilo, mm-hmm. they don't commute to Kona, Kohala. That's hours of their day, and they're part of their community. They really rebuild those communities. So there's a tremendous importance in making this an important item so that the elected officials say, that's important, because it goes back to, even though I think we've had some great successes, I mean, obviously the number one thing the government can do is fully fund the Department of Agriculture. And that's, it gets a tiny, tiny portion of the state budget, in part because although we aspire for local food, we want to eat it, we don't necessarily realize how important it is to make our elected officials aware of that importance, so that and to fully fund it, so that it can in fact do its job.
Very good points, Kyle. Thank you. We're going to take a brief break, and we'll be back. I'm here with Kyle Datta of Ulupono Initiative. We'll be back at the Ruderman Roundtable in just a minute.
Aloha. This is your host, Beatrice Cantelmo. Come and join us every Friday at 4 o'clock on Perspectives of Global Justice.
I'm Jay Fidel, host of Life After Statehood, and I do this with our regular contributor, Rei Tsuchiyama, and we try to make sense of all that has happened in Hawaii, all that is happening, and all that should happen. Rei, what do you think of that show?
I feel delighted to be part of Life After Statehood, since after 59, so many things happened to the state of Hawaii, yet things could have gone in other directions. And that's what I'm fascinated about, that Hawaii has had a great history, but could have an even greater future.
There you go. I believe that. I'm with you all the way. Rei Tsuchiyama and me, Jay Fidel, we do it as much as we can on Life After Statehood. Come around and see what we have to say. Thanks.
Question? No problem.
Aloha and welcome back to the Ruderman Roundtable. I'm Senator Russell Ruderman. I'm here with Kyle Datta of the Ulupono Initiative. We're talking about food issues so far. And I wanted to follow up on one thing you were just saying, Kyle, that you, one of the crucial elements of how the public can support local foods is to buy local foods and to vote with their dollars and support the... Do you think people are willing to pay perhaps a little bit more or go out of their way to support local foods? And what could we do to make that a bigger factor?
Well, you know, it's a great question. And for those of you who know Ulupono, you know we always try to be very objective. And so we want to understand that exact question. So even before we launched, we commissioned OnTrack to do a survey of consumers to understand their preferences and then redid the survey 5 years later. So there's some interesting facts, which is available on our website, about customer preferences. So there's no question that across all the different ethnic groups, local food is desired. Mm-hmm. There's also no question that those people that are more educated, have higher income, more disposable income, therefore tend to not only be willing to pay more for local food, but also shop at different channels. They actually shop in different places and seek out that experience, and they understand its health benefits and are aware of that. For a great deal of the population that shops in either your traditional local retail stores or in the big box stores, so the Costco's, the Walmart's, those kinds of things, they would love to have local food if it could be at parity. And
Same price.
Okay. And you absolutely have to have quality and consistency. It's got to sort of show up each week. It can't sort of, can't be the red light special and then disappear. But that gives us a lot of hope. And because of that knowledge, when we make an investment in Ulupono and local food, our goal is always to hit that mass market. So when we invested in Panayolo Cattle Company, we knew that, you know, the filet mignons and the tenderloins might go to Alan Wong's or other places like that, and sure enough, they did. But we also knew that the hamburger, which is actually what a lot of people eat, the hamburger, would be priced at a point that everyone could afford. And if we did that and we had good quality consistency, that in fact it would fly off the shelves, exactly what it's doing. It's very important that we recognize consumers in different segments. But yes, all of them want local food. It's just different affordability levels. And also, it's got to be available where they shop.
It's commendable of you to take into account the ordinary person, if I might say, in the ordinary market, because those are the folks we have to reach to make a serious change.
And it's right there for those of you who look on our websites. It's the first thing in our mission statement. We are here to improve the quality of life for the people of Hawaii. That means everybody.
Wonderful.
And that's important.
Now, I know among the other, among the several partnerships you have, you've been working to develop, help develop some dairy farms, which leads us to the very first question live from our audience that Ruderman Roundtable has had. We have a question from our audience. Why not put dairy farms on the old Maui cane lands where they're growing feed for dairy cows? And this question comes from viewer Tom Bartlett. So how about that? Why not put dairy farms there on the A and B land, I think he's talking about? Is that right?
Well, I think it's certainly one of the places that dairies can go. As you know, there's two dairies that survived on the Big Island. One at a relatively higher elevation, which is better for cows. One at a very low elevation, where it survived, but it's not a great place for cows. Cows are lactating mothers. They get hot, and they don't like the heat. It's just one of those things.
I did not know that. Yeah.
So in terms of, and this, so there's certain places in Maui that are on the former HCNS lands that where there's a good belt of property right around the Kula area, that sort of thing, that is actually ideal for dairy cows. There's probably spots in every county. You know, the trot we chose in Kauai was extremely good because of both the way the airflow worked, but it's a very, very good place for growing grass. Because one of the issues, the reason dairies went out of business, you know, we used to have all the milk we needed.
Right.
And it was in our lifetimes. When we were kids, we had all the milk. In fact, you know, people used to go down Big Island, Mahalehu Dairy, right? The Galimbas used to run that. So what happened? We relied on imported feeds. And so what happened in sort of when the prices spiked up because of energy and speculators, all those guys went out of business and they never came back. And we can't rely on imported feeds. We have to find a way to, you know, use our natural productivity. And the other thing which is important, which I didn't get to, is the importance of soil regeneration. You know, 100 years of plantation agriculture has actually turned the soils underneath those grasses, and HCNS is a good example of this, into deserts. They're actually biological deserts. So one of the great things about animals is they're part of the natural ecosystem, right? As you look at the work of the Savory Institute, animals are what regenerates the grasslands. So the actual grazing of animals tends to actually regenerate the soils. That's the whole essence of regenerative agriculture, along with organic methods of composting, another way of regenerating soils. But so part of our solutions as we think about agriculture is how do we do affordable, sustainable agriculture and regenerate the soils at the same time.
So the grass-fed cattle is doing...
Grass-fed cattle is one of the ways you can do that, whether it's dairies or whether it's beef, they do the same thing.
So to answer the viewers' questions, there are some of the lands on Maui that could potentially be part of it, but a lot of it has to do with elevation.
And also being flat. You have to find flats. Cows don't like to walk up and down hills. They're big pig mothers. They like it flat.
Just like me here. Okay, so we mentioned a couple of things that you do, but can you give us some other examples of illustrate what Ulupono is doing?
The way to think about it is sort of how does this idea of investing across a whole system work? So as I said before, you say, well, where's the gap? Well, there's a big gap in the animal side of what we eat, and we need to have proteins. So how do we solve that gap? And there's animals that eat grass, so we have two grass-fed initiatives, you know, one with Paniolo Cattle for a joint venture of Parker Ranch. That's going very, very well. It's in Safeway. It's delicious. Everyone should go try it out. But we strove for quality, consistency, and affordability with that, and really had to do the work to help bring up the food safety of the whole supply chain so that it could even qualify for safety and now ultimately Costco. For animals, but what about the other animals? Well, the other animals that don't eat grass have to have a feed. So we joined in a public-private partnership with the Department of Agriculture, the USDA, and Oceanic Institute, Hawaii Pacific University, to put a feed mill in Hilo, which is under construction, should be up and operational, and that's designed to research local feeds, but at a scale that's essentially at commercial scale, so that you can do full-scale trials, not little research trials in a lab, but full-scale trials. That's where our extra money came in, to lift that group up so it could do the full scale.
Nice.
And that will open the door to all the different local feeds, whether they end up from ulu or cassava, both good starches, could be corn. There's a number of starches. We have great proteins from some of the waste, the fisheries waste. As you know, there's one of the bills that hopefully will be approved tomorrow will provide some funding for that from the government, public-private partnership. But also the algae farms in Kona also have proteins. We put proteins together with energy sources, carbohydrates, you pretty much get a feed. Then you add the sort of the vitamins for the life cycle. So we're an investor in that as part of our venture philanthropy efforts.
And those let me interrupt you. Where is that feed mill going to be on the Big Island?
It's at the University of Hilo campus in Hilo.
Oh, I see. Just outside.
Yeah.
Hilo. Okay, wonderful.
Yeah. So we have that. We're also investors back to proteins again. Of course, aquaculture is a good way to do it. So we're investors in Kona Kampachi to help scale them up so they can be profitable. That's right outside of Kona. And then there's a number of things we do on the farming sector. And we've done a number of elements to try to help our smaller farmers, which are so important, create virtual scale. So because individually they're such great entrepreneurs, but sometimes they have to band together around distribution, around food safety, around things like that. So strengthening all those communities to help them create that virtual scale that keeps them in the market, but then also eventually will lower their price and let even more people get access to their food. So mm-hmm. and so all of those things together are sort of how we view the ecosystem. And then lastly, we can't forget the people. You know, farmers are actually business people, and so of course training them is very important. So we partnered with Kamehameha Schools, University of Hawaii, around the whole Go Farm initiative with Stephen Chang. And that helps train farmers to not just be great horticulturalists, of course, but also good entrepreneurs so they can be in business. So we try to look at the suite of things that can help.
And briefly, because we only have another minute or so left, what are some of the lessons learned from these endeavors? What have you learned, positive and negative?
Well, I think we learned that on the positive side, partnering and collaboration are absolutely the best way to go. I think if you look at all of our projects where we partner with local companies, local communities, it's really kind of worked out well.
Yes.
I think we've also learned that, you know, there's starting to be in our state, I think some of the polarization that you see on the mainland is happening here. And so you're getting great polarization between what I would call the resort urban communities and agriculture, where even though these lands were reclassified, you're getting pushback from those communities to have agriculture as your neighbors. And whether you're seeing it in our dairy in Kauai, but you're also seeing it in Oahu, in the Central Valley, as well as parts of the eastern side of Oahu, you're seeing it in Maui. So there's a new set of actors, a new dialogue that needs to happen where the people that are living part of the agriculture community have to express their voices so they're really heard and become more of a part of the public process. But of course, they're working from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. So we have to make sure the public process gives them space to do that.
Very good. That's very insightful. I never thought about that in those terms there. Tell me, if people want to learn more about Ulupono Initiative, where can they find you?
So we have a website, www.ulupono.com. If you have interests or things that you want to share with us, it's also info@ulupono.com. And then, you know, we're frequent speakers at a lot of the agricultural events. We're obviously supporters of Farmers Union, Farmers Bureau, Cattle Association, Aquaculture Association. We really do believe in supporting all forms of agriculture. It goes back to the collaboration discussion we had earlier.
Wonderful. You know, I thought I knew a little bit about Ulupono, and honestly, I learned today that I only saw the tip of the iceberg. You guys do a lot more than I realized, and I thank you for doing that. It's exactly what we need in this
Thank you for being our partner and being supportive of agriculture in your whole career, you've done.
So I'm here with Kyle Datta, the managing director, general partner of Ulupono Initiative, and also a wonderful guitar player, if I may add. And we're here on the Ruderman Roundtable, where we're here every other Tuesday on ThinkTech Hawaii. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you again soon.